party, man.
Yeah,
I can dig it.
Stop
it.
Right on.
There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer for only love.
Well,
you know we've got to find a way.
Hello, friends. Welcome to Creative Connections with New Light Theater. This is a little bit of a conversation that we're hosting every other Wednesday at 7 p.m. to chat with some friends and artists about how they are staying creative and keeping those connections during COVID and during quarantine. And I'm so grateful that you're here. My name is Newt Buchanan, and I'm joined by the lovely Lena Mucchetti. Hey, Lena.
Hi, Newton.
How's it going?
It's quarantining.
Quarantining. Yes, it is. Before we get into our guests, I just actually spontaneously had this thought that I should kind of just acknowledge that there's a lot of things going on in the world today and yesterday in the last 48 hours, 36 hours, that may be causing some anxiety and trauma and triggering some people. It is a tragic and gruesome reality that we're living in. But we hope that the work is being done by those who need to do the work. And we hope that the things that we present here are a way of not escaping, but reminding us of the reasons why we are angry and why these things do trigger us. So I just wanted to make sure that I said that and kind of acknowledged some things that are going on in the world before we jump into our show with our delightful and wonderful guest. Lena, who do we have joining us today?
We have Elise Davella or Diavella, depending who you ask.
Yes.
A director, teaching artist, and certified yoga instructor in Philly. She's directed for Simpatico, Juniper Productions, Inishnua, and her own company, Svaha Theater Collective. Whoa. She's resident director at Tyline Theater in New England, which is a Shakespeare company. And she was a Directors Gathering Fellow. And we both happened to live with Mucchetti men. So,
whoa. Lots of
stuff. Yeah.
yeah, she's very delightful. And I'm excited about having her on today so that we can talk about some really cool things that she's, and just kind of figure out what she's been up to during this time. And she also provided us a little video, didn't she?
She did. She's going to be teaching us a lovely yoga flow after this. Yep.
Well, so without further ado, I know I ramble a little bit. Let's introduce Elise Diavella. And we're going to have a little song that lets her come in here.
Oh, I came into her.
Hey, what's happening? Brother,
that's not it. Here it is.
There it is.
This comes in. I'm thinking of this as like, this is your like soundtrack when you're walking down the street. You know?
Yeah, for sure.
Like, you pat me hands, you're like waving everybody. Hey. What's up? Welcome, Elise.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, of course. It's so wonderful to have you here. We've known each other for a while, and we've worked together on a few different things. Maybe one thing. Did we only work together on one thing?
Yeah, Newton, because you never have the time. I've asked you so many times.
So many times. So true. Call me right out. It's so true. Yes, much to Alicia's chagrin, we have tried to work on things before, and I've just not been available. And I don't mean to say that as a brag. I mean to say that that's more like, you know, I feel like I've missed out on so many opportunities to kind of work with a wonderful person. So shame on me for being, yeah, Lena agrees. Shame on me.
Always.
Yeah. The funny thing is I don't have shame. That's the thing.
So true.
You both nod with an agreement. Great. This is good. This is great.
Going well so far.
So just want to also, so, you know, we'll have some people watching, and if you're watching at home, be sure to put any comments or questions in the comments section, and we'll be kind of answering those questions at the end of our session. If you have any questions for Elise, I'm sure she'd be happy to answer them. So, Elise, it's quarantine. What have you been doing during quarantine?
What?
Yeah. No? Or is this more like your regular, like, to be at home? What's your?
I mean, I'm very introverted, personality-wise. Mm-hmm. So this isn't too complicated for me to shift into
isolation mode.
Yeah. Like, yeah. This is kind of like, oh, this is kind of comfortable. I don't have to interact with people too much. That's great. No. it's more Kevin. Kevin is, this is his ideal situation in many ways.
All right.
So he's been doing fine.
And who is Kevin, for those who don't know?
So Kevin is my boyfriend, the other Mukedi.
Yes. So Kevin is the brother of Lena Mukedi's husband, Tom.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's a little, you know, we're just keeping it in the family a little bit here. Yeah. How's that been? How's Kevin? Is he in heaven, or is he?
In most days, I would say yes. But he's also a germaphobe, so I think this is also like a scary situation on that level.
Yeah.
But he loves just being at home, so this for a while was a very nice situation for him.
Great for him. Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I didn't know that he was a germaphobe. Is he home right now? Is he around?
He's downstairs. He has his headphones though on. I don't know if he's listening. Right. He might be listening and not pretending to hear me. But...
joining in right now. Hey, Kevin, if you're joining in right now, hello. I haven't seen you in a while. I hope you're fine. So it's not so difficult for you to be home by yourself or be home a lot. What's the?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I've not really been struggling so much with like not having a lot of interaction. A little bit more recently, I think I've been starting to hit that limit recently where I'm like, oh my God, I'd like to not be afraid to leave my house.
Yeah.
And venture outside, finding ways to still interact with people. And in an odd way, I feel like I've gotten more connected to my family and some friends through this. So I feel like that's been.
Yeah. Has that been distressing or comforting to be more connected to your family?
It's been comforting.
All right. Okay.
Because not always.
That's why I ask. That's the. Yeah. It is why.
Yeah. So that is surprising that it's been good.
Yeah, I know a lot of people who are kind of re-realizing the relationships that they have are that they value those relationships. I should say. And that's kind of been like this. Oh my God, I do love my mom. Sometimes you forget. You shouldn't forget. Moms are precious, and you should not forget that you love them. But sometimes you maybe take things for granted, and I think that is a little bit of what maybe people are realizing. They're like, oh man, I used to take going outside and hanging out with friends for granted. Have you been able to do any socially distanced visits or
I've with my sister, we've every once in a while been going and like standing or sitting outside on my parents' patio just to kind of all be together and far apart. My friend and I have been taking weekly journeys to different places in the city that are doing curbside stuff.
Curbside stuff. That sounds so my friend and I, first of all, you don't even name the person. It's just my friend and I
on you mean adventures
name? For curbside stuff. I'm intrigued, and I think some of the audience has left. So the curbside pickup is really nice for a lot of reasons. I was really worried about, I was in the beginning worried about a lot of things, but I was really worried about some of the local kind of mom and pop kind of actual small businesses that provide services for communities. And I was kind of worried about them, like coffee shops and, you know, delis and certain small supermarkets in certain areas. And so, or not supermarkets, but small markets. And, but I found that a lot of them have figured out ways of still providing some type of service to people. It's been really great.
Yeah, for sure. I've had that same fear. Like the local brunch place in Northern Liberties, Honey's Sit and Eat, if you're familiar, is freaking delicious. And they hadn't really been doing anything, and they finally opened up for curbside pickup, and I was there the first day.
Yes.
To support.
I think it's tricky to try to pivot and find a new way to do something that you've been doing in one way. You figured out that way, and then you have to pivot and change over and try to do something else. You know who else is trying to do that kind of thing? Oh, sorry. Yes, what did you say, Lena?
I was just going to say, actually, one of the most immediate pivots I saw when this started was Elise's yoga studio, though. They were like the first people I noticed that were immediately like, we can't open, so here, we're going to offer you this stuff online and come on in. And then I saw people following suit after that, but that was one of the markers for me of like, oh, we're going to do things differently now.
Mm-hmm. Elise, tell us a little bit about your yoga studio.
Yeah, Tuck Bar and Yoga. It's run by two amazing people. They're both lawyers, and they're so smart. And so, of course, they were the first to jump on, like, we're doing. they've been so wonderful through this, because it was pretty much an instantaneous, like, I work like five jobs in any given time, and it was pretty much instantaneous, like, we're closing.
Yeah.
All your jobs are gone.
Boom, boom, boom. Yeah.
But they were pretty fast to try and provide opportunities for us again. And then they've been continuing to innovate that since, like exploring Zoom classes. And I think they're trying a whole new platform now too soon.
Nice.
Yeah. So.
And how have you've been teaching there for how long?
Oh, maybe like 2 years now. Okay. Right. Yeah.
But you've been a yoga instructor for?
For 6 years.
Nice. Tell us a little bit about that journey. So you're obviously a theater artist, an actor, but then you found yoga. What, tell us about that.
So in college, my advisor was actually my first acting class in college. When I was introducing myself, the teacher interrupted me and he was like, you have jaw tension. And and I was like, okay.
We'll find out where you were in the year and we can pinpoint who that might have been.
There'll be more reasons why you would want to do that. He's an interesting person. Okay. but he ends up becoming my advisor when I go into like the theater major. And he advised me, he was like, you should take up yoga because you have so much tension in your upper body and it's pigeonholing you into these really aggressive roles.
this is the feedback we're all looking for.
Yeah.
When we step into a room.
One of his other favorite advice that I got from him was, you need to start dressing more like a woman.
Nice. I feel like, here's the thing. Can we stop doing this?
can we
just stop? It needs to end. I think that kind of behavior is only acceptable from someone like myself, who can do it with charm and grace.
Oh, okay. You just gave yourself a free pass?
Oh my God.
I would never think to say that to someone. That slot, that square peg does not fit into my round hole. That's a really bad turn.
Nope, don't do that.
Well, there we are. So the advisor. So they said you jaw tension, and they maybe suggested yoga to you, or did you go, maybe I'll do some yoga?
He suggested yoga to me. So I tried a class out in Pittsburgh. That's where I went to college. It was hot yoga, and I almost died. And they did warn you that coming in. They were like, so your first 1 to 2 times, you're probably going to feel like you're going to vomit.
Yeah.
Just go with it. You're going to be fine.
Yeah.
It'll pass.
Yeah.
Lena,
have you ever done hot yoga, Lena?
I have not. I know another Philly actor very well, who's a hot yoga instructor, but I'm down here in Philly, or in Delaware, and Philly is quite a haul, so I've never actually gotten up there to take
go on it. To the class.
My first class with Elise was on Facebook Live post-pandemic, because now I could take her class.
Ooh, accessibility.
Yes. Silver linings of the pandemic.
Yeah. Well, I've done some hot yoga. I'm quite the flexible, limber lad, as they say. What'd you say? Yeah, they call me Newt the limber lad is what they
noodle.
Say.
He's a noodle.
Yeah, noodle. It's exactly. So you went to yoga, you went to be an instructor. How many hours is that to become an instructor? I used to know, but
the trainings are usually 200 hours for standard. Mine was 250, because we started with like the immersion, which was 50 hours, which was more like philosophy based. And then the actual training was more physical based, but then like it also came with a lot of other stuff too.
Yeah. Well. That's fantastic. You've seemed so comfortable in it when I watched the video, and you seem in like, you're a great instructor and kind of leading people through the movements and those kinds of things. So I really have enjoyed that. I've also had the pleasure of being directed by you in a small reading. What was the name of that show?
Tomcat
with Inish Nua. Yeah. That was really great. We've been trying to work on things for a long time.
And we
finally worked on something, and it was a reading, and it was a wonderful experience. I have a question I've been meaning to ask you. How did I do? How was I?
You did not disappoint, Newton.
Ah, great. That's I thought so. Because if the answer was anything else, I'd just deny it and say that you're a liar. So
this is your show. So
yep. Seems they shouldn't have done this. I'm thinking about how we were referring to restaurants and local businesses kind of having to pivot because of the situation that we're in. Another kind of market that has kind of had to pivot as well is theater and theater companies and artists. And you mentioned that like as soon as things start to shut down, a lot of your jobs, many of the jobs that you had were starting to go away. So what are some of the things that, I mean, if you're comfortable telling me the things that kind of were running through your head at that time, some of the same things that ran through everyone else's heads, but what have you, what did you do to try to like process and work through that?
So I'm someone who's definitely very like, go, 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 go. So like when it happened, I just tried to keep going, which I think a lot of people's response was like, it's gonna be fine. It's gonna be fine. We're gonna keep going and it's gonna work. And then I had a moment where I just, there was a moment at home where I like physically like could not move. I just kind of like sat. I was trying to do a task and just like could not continue with it. Wow. And that's when I started really facing it. Like I was like looking around this room I'm sitting in right now, like at all my theater books and plays and like remembrances from shows, and just like, oh my God, like has the thing I've devoted my many years of my life to now dead?
Yeah.
And has, and I almost felt like I felt like angry. I felt betrayed by it because of how quickly it was like, boom, you're done.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's like, oh my God. So there was, I had to kind of stop for a while. I just kind of like didn't try for a while. Like the whole, like people like pushing to be creative and this is the time to like, I couldn't deal with that for maybe like the first 2 or 3 weeks. I was like, I can't.
Yeah.
Even.
Yeah.
Take that in right now.
Yeah. I was a big proponent of people taking breaks, or even just realizing that, like, even though the feelings that you're having are really devastating and real, it's happening to almost everybody. Like anyone that I would like reach out to was in the same boat of having, you know, their own journey through what's going to happen to me? What's happening to this craft that I love? And there's like uncertainty. Lena, you can speak to that too, right? You were having some feelings of.
Yeah. I mean, we talk about restaurants and businesses pivoting and the yoga classes going online, and that is amazing. And it's not the same as being in person, but when you talk about trying to pivot theater, that's almost impossible. Like we're all trying, like Elise said, we're trying to say it's okay, and we're trying to create and we're trying to figure it out, but it really hinges on togetherness and collaboration, not just between the artists, but between the artists and the audience. There's that give and take. So it's not an industry that can just pivot into an about face and translate into a different medium.
Yeah.
And we're all trying to figure out if there's like some secret crack in the wall here that we can pry open and get through that no one has thought of yet, that we can make this work. But I don't know that anyone's found it yet. So we're just trying to do our best to feed our creative souls and try and keep it alive and keep fanning that little spark so that when we're allowed, it's going to still be there. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I like the idea of like a crack in the wall, as if we're a building. Yeah, yeah. And I gotta get through. I see some light. I smell fresh air. Fresh air is this way. It's you know, I think I was talking earlier about how it's almost like saying to someone who's never like seen a car, "Hey, get into this and drive across the country." You know, like, you know, and there's no precedence for having to make this shift so drastically, in such a dire way. So, you know, and I mean, there have been, you know, some companies have done it and different entities and artists who have done it in maybe varying degrees of success. But the question I pose to you and to those watching right now, if you want to throw some comments in the comment section, is it still theater? Like if we are not on stage, if we're not able to actually be with each other, if we're not actually able to be in front of an audience, is it theater? What do you think, ladies? Is it theater still?
Elise, so something. There's this one podcast I listen to called Three on the Aisle. It's through American Theater, and it's these three critics, and they're really wonderful to listen to. They have a great dynamic. Anyway, but they were talking about this. It was their first episode post-pandemic and talking about all this change. And this one guy made this really great insight that theater is the only art form that's named for the space it takes place in.
Wow.
And that just really resonated with me of like, theater is really, it's about being in the same space with people and directly connecting with people. So yeah, I think no, like when we're trying to do stuff on Zoom, it's not really theater anymore.
Yeah.
It's definitely somewhere in limbo.
Yeah.
Because it's not in that space. It's not in the space that defines what theater is.
What it is.
Yeah.
And it's not film either. It's not theater and it's not film, and it's floating screen as like a placeholder until we can get back to where we want to be.
Yeah. It's an interesting thing. I'm glad, you know, I'm going to use, I'm glad that you answered that for everyone in the Philadelphia theater community. So now we know, you didn't know that that's what you were doing. That's what you did. So thank you. Thank you so much.
I don't want to doubt, like, if that is something that brings people, like has been keeping people afloat, by all means do it.
Yeah. Yeah. We were like, what is it, still theater? And they were like, maybe Elise will answer it. And then you made an attempt, and yeah, I don't know. Well, maybe I'll cut this out. Yeah.
Sure. It's not live.
So tell me a little bit about your theater company. You have a company, yes?
Oh, yeah, Sava. Yeah. So that, it's funny. that came out of grad school. My directing thesis, I directed Sarah Kane's Crave, which was an entire play, which is a little unique to their directing thesis, but it's a short play, so it fit the time constraint. Mm-hmm. And when we finished, it felt so good that I was like, I have a complete product. I want to take this right into the Fringe.
Yep.
And we real quick had to scramble, because I think my thesis took place on like May 26th. And the deadline to register for Fringe is often like the first week of June. So we scrambled real fast within a week.
But you got it in.
Yeah, but we got it in. But we had to make up a company, or like that was the advice I was given, that it would be more well received if you were a company producer.
A company of some sort. Yeah, sure.
So I was like, okay, we'll just come up with a name real fast.
Uh huh. And you're like, Sva.
Yeah. So Sva is, it comes from yoga. It was a Sanskrit word that some people translate as to like into the fire. And that's something, a sentiment that's always resonated quite a bit with me. So it's like, okay, yeah, into the fire. I think that embodies this show that we're about to produce and the way that we're producing it. That we're just kind of like, all right, let's do it.
How I feel right before we go live here on Facebook. I'm like, going into the fire. Here we go. Here we go. Somehow we come out on the other end. And not because of me. So your theater company for the Fringe, what year was that Fringe?
2016.
Oh, cool. So you've been around for a little bit.
Yeah.
Nice. And then have you done some other Fringe shows or some other productions?
Yeah, we did an adaptation of, what was that Strindberg play? Miss Julie. And we did, oh gosh, the most recent one we did was Phaedra's Love, another Sarah Kane.
Yeah.
And an adaptation of Henry the Eighth.
Yeah.
That we paired together as kind of like a, we called it the Crown is Burning series.
You guys like fire.
We do. Sorry, Grandma. One day I'll get fire on stage.
I saw Miss Julie, and I think I saw Phaedra's, Fire as well.
Phaedra's Love.
So yeah. I'm stuck on the fire.
There is fire in the show.
Yeah. And I just remember having, like, after each show, having like these kind of really in-depth conversations with you about your process and your thought patterns for like telling that story as a director. Lena, this is also for you, because Lena's also a director here. I'm sandwiched by lady directors right now. Just how I like it. Tell us a little bit about your process of approaching a piece of work and what kind of work kind of fuels that fire in you.
Yeah. So Crave was the first show I ever, like the first full show I ever directed. And I kind of always, that's become my baseline of what I'm searching for, because the experience working with the, and so like just the process, me and the actors bonded so much throughout the course of the show. And it was like a really meaningful experience, I think, for all of us as we were putting it together. And then when we presented it to people, I just remember at the end of one performance, at the end of several performances, really, that the reaction from the audience was to just, they just sat there for a couple moments. And then their first reaction was to reach out to the person next to them. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we were able to generate that kind of response, that kind of like visceral need for community, that's kind of what I've been chasing ever since in everything that I do. Wow. So I definitely want to create a meaningful experience for everyone in the room with me while we're putting it together. And then for the audience in the aftermath of that.
That's amazing. For Tomcat, I didn't experience that. I didn't have that feeling with you. So feeling gypped.
We had like five hours
of rehearsal. I think you're right. I think what you're kind of tapping into there is what I think a lot of artists are also realizing as they are like realizing that they shouldn't take certain things for granted, that community and telling a story in a way that evokes feeling someone else or in a group of people is a really powerful experience to be on either side of that. And so I think it just reminds us of why we do the things that we do, why it's so important. So that's really awesome. Let's see, where are we right now? I have another question for you. So this is a weird time, right? And is it sip time?
Oh,
it's sip time. Sip o'clock. Yep.
It's a weird time.
Mm-hmm. It's weird times. And kind of like what we were talking about before, having moments of like, I needed to just sit and like look around the room and process what's happening to me. What are some things that you found during quarantine that have kind of been fortifying your armor? Or how have you been being kind and gentle with your little soul?
So I love the fortifying your armor. I love that so much. So it started like when I was kind of like taking my break. I was allowing myself to have bad days, which is something I don't let myself do. So I was allowing myself to be like, nothing's gonna happen today, because that's what I feel like. Right. And just kind of letting that happen. Essentially letting myself have like a mental health day, which is insane, because in my work I try to examine like mental health a lot, and I don't really follow it for myself. But yeah, so I was letting myself have those days and letting myself feel bad and just letting that go. And then slowly I started to come back and feel that spark again. And I thought the two things that really brought me back were the one so silly. Kevin and I watched Oklahoma.
The musical?
Yes, the National Theater with Hugh Jackman. And that just like reignited my soul in such a weird way.
Nothing like Hugh Jackman to fortify your arm.
I had never seen Oklahoma before. Uh-huh. I only knew like the first song, and that was all I was familiar with. And it's just something about that musical, that production, that just made me want to do theater again.
Like, this is it. Well, I wonder if the feeling was like, oh yeah, I remember that, or like, oh, I can do that better.
No, it was beautiful.
Okay, all right.
It really was. And then directors gathering had posted about the New York Theater Workshop, and they were starting this like virtual programming, and their first masterclass they offered was with Rachel Chavkin, who directed Hadestown.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't seen the show, but I had seen enough to know I want to know what she has to say in a masterclass. Mm-hmm. So I signed up for it on Zoom, and it was like, holy shit, like, I'm gonna what?
Yeah. Like, yeah, that I'm in itself. Zoom with her. Like, okay, great. What? Great.
And she just, everything that she had to say, like that learning again, like just trying to like take in new strategies and ways of thinking about directing helped me come back, because it was something I was realizing I was missing before this, was that I was just like moving, next thing. You don't need time to prep. But really I do. And I want a long prep process.
Long prep, yeah.
Actually being able to slow down and learn was like, oh my God, this is what I want.
Yeah, it's not very often that we do get a chance to learn. I think it's almost like when we're doing theater, we don't go see theater, right?
Yeah.
Like when we're in the middle of doing theater, we also don't go try to learn about it or put ourselves in a place of a student anymore, especially post some undergrad.
Yeah, because you're too busy trying to like project this image of like, I'm a professional, hire me.
Yeah. You're busy trying to make a living, right? So
yeah.
Yeah. And it's interesting that when that need to make a living is taken away, that we fall back on, well, how can I see more theater like Oklahoma and be transcended, you know, or how can I put myself in a place of a student? Very interesting.
Yeah.
You talked about two things. I also have been on a number of the New York Theater Workshop online sessions, and they've just been really great and so insightful. And a few people, like I've seen Thaddeus Phillips was on there doing a one, and he's just kind of a kooky dude, and some other folks, and it's just been really great. And I agree with you about, you know, getting into back into like a student way of just a student mindset of like, now I'm just gonna like try to learn and fill in some gaps. And I also think that what's really great about this is that a lot of institutions and companies are kind of like, well, we can't do any theater, so let's just have this person, they're home, hop on a Zoom and get some other people on there and have a conversation with them. Whereas like, if that had happened before, we wouldn't have gone. We wouldn't have been able to get in the room. We wouldn't have been able to see it, that kind of thing. So it has been kind of opening up, I think, a different thing. And then you talked about the directors gathering.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about that.
So directors gathering, that's was founded by Jill Harrison, who is probably the nicest person on planet Earth.
She really is.
She's so nice. they have, if you're a member, they share like all kinds of opportunities and stuff with you. So that's where I got wind of the masterclasses with New York Theater Workshop, because they just are constantly posting different things like that, different like fellowships you can apply for, jobs. I think I've definitely gotten jobs because of stuff they've posted. And yeah, they're fantastic.
It's a collective of directors in the Philadelphia.
It's just like a gathering, if you will, of Philadelphia. theater directors.
A murder of directors
is right. Right. If you put too many, that was always kind of my struggle with it. Cause like directors tend to be very type A individuals. And when you put them all in the same room together, it's a little difficult sometimes. So when I was a fellow, sometimes I was like, oh, this is a lot for me.
Well, it's okay. They're all watching right now. So go ahead and speak your mind.
No, they're lovely people. It's just like more me.
I see. Oh, I got it. Know thyself. So a gathering, a murder of directors that kind of get together and talk about the craft and kind of share resources and try to grow and expand and learn from each other.
Yeah, and they offer classes too that you can participate in.
That's very cool. From what I can tell, it's mostly female. Is that correct? Female directors?
There are, yes. Yeah, probably. But there are male identifying people who pop up every once in a while.
Female identifying.
But yeah, in my fellows group, we were all women.
Cool. That's great. It's amazing. I think it's really good. The future is women.
One might say.
One might say. Great. Excellent. And I was going to ask you something else, but I think I'd like to go to our comment section to see if there's anyone who's got some questions for our guest here as we go on to sip time. What do we got, Lena?
We have one from Carlin who said, you mentioned acting yourself early on, but then you made the transition to directing. What pushed you to make that shift, and how do you approach the role of director differently than you approach the role of actor?
That's a very good question. So I thought I was an actor at first. When I graduated college, I thought I was an actor. And I did that for a little bit. And then I realized that I didn't want it enough to deal with the shit you have to deal with to become an actor. So that was kind of eye-opening. So that's when I went to grad school, because I was like, I know I want to be in theater, but I'm not sure I know what I want to do anymore in it. But I had like an inkling. I was like, I think it might be directing, but I'm not sure. So I went into Villanova's MA program, which is it's intensive, but it's general. And I went on the directing track, which led me to that. And then I realized, oh, yes, this is really what I want to do.
This is what I want to do.
Yeah. Oh, this feels good. I will put up with the crap I have to put up with to do this. I think that's the key, really, in theater. Like, you have to want it enough to put up with
this
whatever it is you got to do to do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because there's some
stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is.
Not easy.
I'd say almost every role in theater has, like, this stuff around it that kind of defines it, but it's also like this, it's crap that we all kind of have to get through. And some people are better with it and some people aren't. Some people really love all parts of it, even the tough parts. So
you really have to prove yourself for don't know, like 10 years. It's different for everybody, but
6 months for me, you know, I don't take that.
Oh god.
Sorry, Alina, did you have something? I'm sorry, what? What did you say, Alina?
I said nothing.
Oh, okay. I thought you had something to say about that.
No.
No? Okay. Anyway. Cool.
But definitely, for the second part, I think, like, how does that affect my directing? And I've had actors say this to me, which is very nice of them to notice. But I do try. So in my mind, the actor is getting into the character's brain in a way that I can't, because I have to look at the full picture, and that has to be my priority as the director. So there is just no way that I'm ever going to be inside of the character in a way that the actor is. So I try to make sure my actors know that, like, if I ask you to do something that doesn't feel right, like, I want your opinion on that. And we can have it should always be a conversation. Like, if you feel something, tell me and let's explore that. And I'm willing to, like, let's go wherever this thing's going to take us, you know? Like, obviously I come in with a plan, but I think you also have to be willing to throw that away.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. The collaborative spirit of the theater. Lena, you gave a little, a little amen over there. So what's your...
Yeah, I think I have not worked with Elise, but I think, I imagine our approaches are pretty similar in that way. And our paths sound pretty similar too, in that I was primarily an actor and that was where I focused all of my college education. And then when I got to Philly, I didn't quite know where to begin to get into the industry, and someone offered to let me assistant direct for them. And so I didn't have the benefit of classes that I took, and I didn't go back to grad school, but I sort of learned by ADing, which had never been a path that I was actively seeking, but it felt more right. And I also realized how much I hated auditioning, and I hated all of the stuff that I had to do to try and make it as an actor. But I loved enabling other people to be able to do that. Mm. And so I think I approached directing with the actor's mindset at the forefront. So yeah, I feel shockingly similar.
I'm just an actor. thanks for asking, everybody. You're right. Every role in theater and every part has its different kind of stuff that goes along with it. And you're right. One of the things that does make an actor kind of rethink things is the audition process. And it is.
Hate it.
It's brutal.
It can be. Yeah. Yeah.
And then as a director, really tried to make that less horrible in every way that I can when people audition.
I do too. I try to be as kind as I can be. And
yeah.
I'm socially awkward, so sometimes I need them to make me feel better.
They're giving you a piece of stranger, and it's a situation, and I don't want to ever take that for granted, what they're putting out there, you know?
Yeah. I think let's just to briefly go into the casting. So because the two of you have done bits of that, and we can briefly kind of dip into that casting and how do you want people to feel, and what's your approach to casting, and what should, you know, if actors are stepping into a casting room audition with you, what's the one or few messages you want to get across to them?
So I will say, so starting to be behind the table, everything people tell you about how, like, the minute you walk in the room, it matters, it does. And you start, from being behind the table, I start to realize that, like, holy cow. Like, I start taking information in the minute that person walks in the door.
Yeah.
Like, just, like, stupid stuff. Because it's also, like, you're trying to decide, like, do I want to work with this
person? Do I want to be in a room with this person?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What's the stupid stuff? You were kind of like, that you'd like to...
Like, I don't know, like, this is where it gets, like, bad when you start to think about your inner monologue, when you're trying to assess people, like,
he didn't even tie his shoes.
Yeah, like, or like, oh, that person looks full of themselves, I don't know, like, like, it's, you know what I mean? Something I always look for, because I am, like, introverted and socially awkward, but I am trying to, like, make them feel better. When an actor makes me instantly feel more comfortable by starting a conversation with me when they walk in the room, that's automatically someone I am attracted to. I'm like, oh my God, they're making me feel more comfortable through this. I like them. And someone who shows me something I didn't expect out of a character, like something I didn't think of, is normally someone who's going to go,
yeah, right, like, oh, that was an interesting take on that. Even if I haven't had many times behind the table, but even if it's something that you won't use, but they've come in and they've brought it and it's very convincing, and you can have the conversation about how they got there.
Yeah, that's important too, when they can, because I'm definitely a big proponent of, like, I hope that you've done your homework, so if I can suss out that in our conversation that you've done that. That's like another part of that. Yeah, like being able to articulate why they made the choice.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
What about you, Lena?
Oh yeah, the homework. I always send sides and materials at least a week before the audition. So I don't, in the age of Google, want to hear an actor in the audition room tell me that they don't know what's happening in the scene. So can I explain it to them? Or I don't know, you know, how what this character is referring to here. These are easily Googleable answers if you can't get your hands on the script, and most of the time you probably can. And I've said to you a week ago or 2 weeks ago, like, hey, here's your sides. If you have any questions at all, please let me know. I'm happy to help you out with that. And it's kind of surprising that happens, that people will walk in and be like, I was going to, can you just tell me what's happening in the scene?
I have no idea. I'm sorry. Yeah. Yeah. It's true. It happens to all of us.
And also another thing that people always say that is actually true from behind the table is that we want you to succeed. Like, nobody's rooting for you to fit. We want to have the problem of having so much talent and love and joy in the room that we just can't pick. So everybody is rooting for you. And I try to make that clear to everybody who walks in the door too.
Yeah. So the lessons that I'm getting from this are know your homework and bribe the director on the way in.
Slip them
a 50 in the bathroom when you bump into them.
Are you going to bump into us in the bathroom?
I'm sorry, what? Huh?
So do you have a lightning round for us, Newton?
I do have a lightning round. So at least we're going to go through a lightning round, ask some questions. Yeah, get sipping on that. Sip a clap. Just ask you a couple of random questions. All you need to do is just answer them. There's no explanation unless I would like one. And then we're going to slip into the 10 questions that are asked on like the Actor Studio, because I just think those questions are interesting and they elicit some really cool things. So first question is tea or coffee?
Oh, coffee.
Coffee. Nice. How do you like your eggs?
Over easy.
Oh. Ooh. Okay. What's the best way to cool off on a hot summer's day?
Hot shower.
Hot shower?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I need an explanation.
It cools you down. My uncle, who was a nurse, I remember we were at like an amusement park and I was complaining about how hot I was. And he was like, you need to go home and take a hot shower. And I don't know, there's something about your physiology. It like opens up your pores. So it starts to cool you down. In Streetcar Named Desire, Blanche takes hot baths to cool herself down.
She does take hot baths to cool herself down.
She's also a crazy person, so I'm not sure.
Well, she also, maybe she runs hot. Maybe she's hotter than the water that she drew.
You shouldn't take all of Blanche's life advice. Just the hot bath.
It's just the hot bath?
Just the hot bath.
I think the rest of it's pretty sound. No? It's pretty sound. I'd be that show. What's your hot take on theaters opening soon? Live gonna happen, but so your life on hot take on theaters that are going to open soon.
Who?
Nope, it's not that kind of show.
I think that was her hot take, though.
That was her hot take. Cool. Excellent. I asked this last week, what's the best place for ramen in Philly? Do you like ramen noodles?
Not enough to offer a good place.
Then let's not ask that question.
Okay.
Oh, best way to have potatoes.
Oh.
I know. That's
for what meal?
I don't know. You tell me.
It makes a difference. All right, I'm gonna go with a latke.
Oh, that's a good choice. Mm-hmm. For what meal?
Breakfast. but really any.
All right, let's go through these questions really quick. What is your favorite word?
God, I don't know. That is so difficult. Oh my God, I'm blanking completely
right now.
And the pressure is making it worse.
I'm gonna go with sava.
I was gonna say okay. That.
Into the fire. You're like, that perfect. Resonates with you. Perfect. Okay, this one's gonna be more difficult. What is your least favorite word?
My least favorite word?
Yeah.
Oh boy. Yeah, I'm not a very verbal person.
Okay. Like, some people don't like the word moist.
That's a good one. I don't dislike the word moist.
Okay.
It's a good directing word.
what in what directing? This scene is a little dry. I think it needs to be more moist.
Really? But honestly.
Oh, okay.
If you're an actor and you got that note,
you better do it. Better do
the
it.
The more descriptive, the better.
I like it. Okay. What turns you on?
Intelligence?
What turns you off?
Smugness.
Oh.
So Newton.
So me? Is it me? Is it
maybe.
Me? what sound or noise do you love?
Ooh, you know, I love the sound of a can opening.
Oh, that is a good sound. Mm-hmm. What sound or noise do you hate?
Sound or noise do I hate? Ooh, the sirens.
On like an ambulance or a car of police.
Yeah, or like a car alarm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. What is your favorite curse word?
Probably fuck. I probably say it way more than I should.
What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
Oh, so many. I dream about this all the time.
Okay.
I feel like as a theater artist, you have to. I'm constantly like asking people, What do you do? Tell me about your life.
Yeah.
but I've thought about being like a physical trainer is a life I feel like that I'd drive with, or a food critic.
Oh.
I'd love to be a judge on like Top Chef.
That's my kind of thing, man. That's my kind of thing.
I can't cook, but I like to eat.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you said you don't a lot, but you are prepared to judge other people's cooking.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Those who can't do, judge. What profession would you not like to do?
Probably probably like any kind of desk job. I don't think I could deal with a desk job.
Got it. Cubicle, cube farm type of thing. Got it. So the office is not appealing to you.
Oh, I love the are you talking about the show?
And if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
This is the one question I remember him asking.
Yeah.
You made people happy, probably. Oh,
that's a good one. Great. Well, Elise, thank you so much for joining us. I think you did pretty well there. I'm sorry if we stressed you out with a lightning round. You're like,
I'll come back an hour later with my favorite word.
You're like, but I have answers.
Put a comment on your own video.
Yeah, exactly. So you, as part of doing this with us, you have a video that you've recorded and that we're going to share. Can you tell us just really briefly about that video?
Yeah, so it's a really quick, like 10-minute yoga sequence. It's very gentle, very stretchy. So great for when you wake up in the morning or before you go into a rehearsal, whenever you can do that again. Or just whenever you need a pick-me-up in the middle of your day. So it's just a great way to get kind of refocused and energized without exhausting yourself.
Thank you. And then for those who are watching that might want to check you out or check out any of your online classes, any of your yoga instruction that you have going on, or just want to reach out to you and friend you on Instagram or Facebook, how can you do that?
So I'm teaching for, we talked about Tuck Bar Yoga. So to take those classes, you just got to like them on Facebook. And I teach for Tula Yoga Philly, who are new Northern Liberties based, but not currently, they're virtual. They're doing Zoom classes. So you sign up on their website, and it's donation based. And what else did you say? I'm on
anywhere that you might be that people to people to find you that you want them to.
Oh, I am on Instagram.
Don't have to share your Instagram if you don't want to. We'll put it in the video when we share it for them. So no problem. Yeah, we'll do that. Excellent. All right. Well, thank you so much, Elise. Lena, did you have anything that you wanted to add before we close out?
Thank you so much. The video is dropping now, so everyone can follow along with some before bed yoga today.
Perfect. And join us 2 weeks from now for our next session. We have a very special guest coming in, and we hope that you enjoyed your time here. And I'm just going to play us out with a little bit of Marvin Gaye. Thank you, everybody. Bye, friend.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying.